So, you've got the Apostle Paul, on the one hand, apparently saying that all you have to do is believe and you're saved. And then you have the Apostle James, on the other hand, saying salvation is not by faith alone. Are they contradicting one another? Hardly. Both wrote what they wrote under the direct divine inspiration of God's Holy Spirit. So all that's really happening is you have Paul establishing firmly the reality that nobody deserves heaven. If you're ever going to get there, Paul teaches us that it will be because you trusted in the written guarantee in the Word of God that, quote, Christ died for the ungodly, end quote. And that, quote, whoever comes to Jesus, he will never turn away, end quote. And at the same time, you have the Apostle James establishing firmly that while that is true, you better test your faith. You better make sure it's real, because true faith, James teaches, always produces obedience to God. It gives a genuine believer a new love and a new power to be able to obey God's commands. God's grace, when it's the real McCoy, gives the person who receives it a new heart and a new nature that is inclined to do good works and to obey and to serve God. So, that's the doctrine. That's the teaching about God and how we can go to heaven that is found in the New Testament. And that the story of Noah's Ark in the Old Testament is going to help us to better understand. And as I said earlier, our program called Salvation by Grace looked at Paul's emphasis more closely. But this program, well, it looks more closely at the side of the truth that the Apostle James teaches us about. That faith without deeds is useless. So let's take that closer look right now.
Rain, rain on my face. Hasn't stopped raining for days. My world is a flood. Slowly I become one with the mud.
But if I can't swim after 40 days, then my mind is crushed by the crashing waves that feel so high. And I cannot fall, let me alone. Lift me up when I'm falling. Lift me up when we get
down. Most people think of Noah's Ark. The Hallmark version or some cartoon version typically comes to mind. But the reality is, the Ark looked more like this. You see, the actual Ark wasn't really designed to travel anywhere. And certainly, speed wasn't a necessary feature. It just needed to float stably, without rocking. So it was little more than a large three-story shoebox with a roof and lots of compartments inside. And while there's all kinds of interesting little trivia about Noah's Ark, the real lesson of the Ark is what it can teach us about how a person is saved from the consequences that their sin has brought. Or in other words, how we are saved from hell and brought safely to heaven. And here's the truth I want you to hear loud and clear right up front. Despite what you may often hear today, despite the modern church's fascination with easy believism, the Bible, God's Word, teaches us that we should be willing to engage in and to go through a great deal in order to eventually see heaven. So please don't be deceived by yourself or by others. Right up front, you should know that even though it is categorically true that we cannot earn heaven, the prudent person, before they choose to become a disciple of Jesus Christ, should count the cost. Because the price is expensive. Unless you think that's just my opinion, let me quote Jesus Christ himself. Jesus in Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, put it this way. He said,
"If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it.
You know, Jesus often taught about the self-denial and sacrifices that anyone who wanted to follow him would face. Not because he wanted to scare them, but because he wanted to prepare them. And again, it's a good thing to tell people about the love of God when we evangelize. But it's also a vital part of the equation to let people know that they need to count the cost. Well, Jesus sure did. Here, listen to another passage in Luke's Gospel this time, chapter 14. It reads, quote,
"Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them he said, 'If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple.'"
And then Jesus went on to illustrate his point with this story. He said,
"Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he's able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still long a way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple."
And then, as if to be double sure that the people understood this issue of following him seriously or not, he gave this all-or-nothing proposition. He said,
"Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for soil nor the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear."
Do you know why Jesus said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear"? Doesn't everybody have ears? He said that because a man's spirit must be born again. It must have been made alive by God through salvation by grace in order for that person to even have the necessary spiritual ears to hear and to be able to fully grasp any message that Jesus teaches. And so Jesus would often speak in parables. Parables that were just confusing or foolish to unbelievers, but that, quite the opposite, made it easier for true believers to see and grasp the spiritual truths that Jesus was teaching. So let's use the picture of salvation given to us in this Old Testament story of Noah's Ark in a similar way that Jesus himself used parables in order to see if it will help us understand it all a little bit better. And may God bless his truth to your hearts. I'd like you to think about something. God, in the book of Genesis, commands Noah to build the ark to save himself and his family. And Noah complies. So here's my question. Did Noah's faith save him, or did the ark save him?